notes, or she notes that the credibility findings and the medical opinions are not challenged by you. Is that accurate?
They're not challenged explicitly, but it's something that I do want to address more in the terms of how the residual functional capacity analysis and the function by function analysis was or was not done.
Well, the reason I ask that question is in your reply brief, you didn't respond directly to those two comments that the commissioner made.
Right, because with respect to the opinion and the assessment by Dr. Moitoike and the state agency medical examiners, the point that the concern that I had there was that the agency, in coming up with it, the decision that it did, the agency, and if I put the cart before the horse in that, it seems to me that the agency decided upon the RFC and then made everything else fit that. For example, with respect to Dr. Moitoike's opinion and the state agency's medical opinion, the decision says that their assessed weight, to the extent that they are consistent with the RFC.
Is that a correct legal standard, consistent with the RFC? Well, consistent with his, I think the ALJ said it was consistent with the opinion that the ALJ was writing.
Right.
Is that the standard he should be using, or should it be something more explicit?
It should be more explicit, yes. And the reason that gets back to the argument that we make with respect to the function-by-function analysis, that is, the SSR and even the ALJ's decision itself points out that what the RFC is to be the result of a function-by-function analysis in more detail than just the initial paragraph B criteria that was examined at step two.
So your position is you fairly raised these issues and that you didn't respond to the commissioner's assertions that you weighed both of those arguments about credibility and medical opinions, that indeed, by virtue of the nature of what you asserted, they were inherently involved in that.
They were in the sense that because the agency constructed the RFC and did not do the function-by-function analysis in detail as it says that it should, and found that those opinions were acceptable and given weight only to the extent that they were consistent with the already arrived at residual functional capacity. And that's why in the briefing that we're saying that's putting the cart before the horse, because if you look at excerpt 29 in the ALJ's decision, it's page 5 of 11, right at mid-page, just before the ALJ announces the actual RFC. He points out and takes his strength from the SSR 96-8P that the ALJ will now go in, or is supposed to go into more detail about the function-by-function analysis, that the Part B analysis at step 2 was not the detailed analysis that is now called for. And so what I'm saying is that the ALJ or the agency decision then found those opinions to be consistent only with the RFC that had already been derived. What I'm saying is that they should first do the function-by-function analysis in order to arrive at the residual functional capacity.
So did the ALJ adequately take account of her mental illness and looking to the grants and making the finding about unskilled work?
My contention would be no, Your Honor. I could give you an example, too. It's in the transcript at the very end. It's the last item in the colloquy with the after the ALJ examined the vocational expert and then turned it over to the representative. This is on excerpt 84. 84, excerpt 84, yes. And so the page before the colloquy with the vocational expert begins on 83, and basically the ALJ then asks the VE to identify herself. She does so, and then asks if she needs to know anything more in order to do what she's then asked to do, which is to classify the past relevant work. She then classifies the past relevant work, and the ALJ says that's all the questions that he has. Then the representative steps in, and he asks, well, what about 10% off time? What about 15% off time? But this is a reflection, I would submit to you, Your Honor, that to the level of one instance in which the ALJ did not sufficiently examine the function-by-function assessment, this is an obvious one. And the ALJ could have pursued that, could have developed more aspects, as we pointed out in the brief, by simply asking the vocational expert.
But was there evidence, medical evidence, that your client could not stay on task for 15% of the day?
There is evidence, but I would suggest that it's not been assessed because we cannot be sure of that. We have the evidence of how her condition is now. It has changed over time, as the record reflects. Fortunately, it seems that they have achieved some level of amelioration in her condition. But we don't know if that is sufficient now to enable her to engage in substantial gainful activity. That also leads me to just a quick side point. Part of the difficulty that we have with this decision, the final agency decision, is the ALJ does not speak in terms of ability to do substantial gainful activity. The ALJ speaks of the ability or asserts that Barbara Ressler and Ms. Schindler, her mother, are alleging inability to do all work. Well, that's not the standard. That's not what they're alleging. We know that in disability claim, the standard is substantial gainful activity. Part of an application of understanding the final agency decision here is that from time to time it speaks of the ability or inability to engage in all work, but that's not the standard.
Did ALJ adequately consider the obesity factor?
The ALJ took into account obesity and simply indicated that that's the reason why the exertional level of light exertion was arrived at. And I think under the circumstances, it's sufficient under this circumstance. The major concern is the failure to do the function-by-function analysis that would inform the RFC, as the ALJ said that he would do, and that's on excerpt 29, as I said, just before finding number 4, and points out that the function-by-function analysis is supposed to be in greater detail than was done at step 2. That somewhat addresses the point that the commissioner addressed in her supplemental authority, citing Hupai. But Hupai, neither Holden and Hupai really has direct application here. By the way, the ALJ's finding with respect to the greater detail of function-by-function analysis at excerpt 29 is a direct reflection of SSR 96-2B at page 4 of the Westlaw version of that. I see that I have just a minute. May I reserve that?
Yes, you may.
Thank you.
Some of the facts in this case are dramatic. The legal issues before the court are narrow and straightforward. Before I turn to the legal arguments raised by Ms. Ressler, I want to point out that the relevant period of this case is very narrow. Ms. Ressler didn't apply for SSI until August of 2010, and the ALJ issued this decision in August of 2012. Ms. Ressler needed to establish she was disabled for at least 12 consecutive months in that two-year period. And the record demonstrates that with treatment, Ms. Ressler was mentally conditioned starting to improve not long after she applied for SSI. What it shows is that in May of 2011, she changed her medication, or her providers changed her medication, and after that, she reported improvement, and there was a consistent pattern of improvement after that point. We have doctors describing her symptoms as mild and then later borderline. In light of this record, it was reasonable for the ALJ not to find her disabled during the relevant period. She seems to rely very heavily in her brief on records from before the relevant period, but those don't establish disability after August of 2010.
Well, the same question that I have for you. What do you make of your argument that that the weight of the evidence and the credibility determinations have been waived?
Well, I do believe they've been waived. I mean, in both the district court and before the this court. In our response brief, we pointed out that plaintiff did not directly challenge them, and there was no pushback on that statement at all in either brief.
Does the function-by-function analysis inherently involve credibility and medical opinions?
No, it does not. It does not, number one, and number two, the function-by-function analysis. This court has been very clear in multiple cases that a formal function-by-function analysis as part of the RFC discussion is not required, that all that's required is that the ALJ support the RFC finding with the facts. In any event, in this case, the medical opinions are entirely consistent with the RFC. We have Dr. Matoika who performed the consultative examination, and Dr. Matoika only observed or only opined that this claimant had mild limitations. And then we have two state agency doctors that assessed Ms. Ressler's functioning based on the medical records.
Is the standard correct when he uses the phrase to the extent consistent with? In other words, he doesn't do a comparison of the treating and the examining and the non-examining. He simply says to the extent consistent with. So we really never know what he's rejected or what he's accepted, but it's just pretty vague.
Well, you know, when a medical opinion is consistent with an RFC, the articulation requirement is lessened. When you have a medical opinion that is contrary to the RFC, then the obligations, you know, the ALJ's obligations to discuss the reasons for differing or the reason for the difference between the RFC and the opinion is heightened. So we don't have that in this case. And I point out that both of the state agency doctors, in their case analysis, both of them said that the claimant would be able to perform simple, unskilled work. And with respect to the first state agency doctor, that's at page 145 of the administrative record. With respect to the second state agency doctor, that is at page 159 of the administrative record. So both are saying explicitly that her limitations are consistent with unskilled work, which is what
the fact that she hears voices on a continuing basis and finds that distracting, isn't that an essential problem for this person to actually work?
Well, what's interesting is while she does report that she hears voices, number one, there is improvement, but these doctors are also assessing her functioning before the improvement. And while she does hear these voices, she's actually able to relate to the providers that she meets very, very well. When they have mental status exams, and her mental status exams are largely normal, she does not show in her relation to them evidence of, she doesn't show evidence of delusional thinking in talking to them. She reports that she experiences them, but she actually relates very, very well to providers. And, you know, tellingly in this case, no doctor provided, there's no treating doctor who says she has limitations beyond unskilled work. The only evidence here is her subjective reports of that. And as I noted, pointed out in our brief, there are a number of cases from this and from other circuits where claimants have these sort of mental impairments where they have hallucinations or delusions are found to be able to work.
Her essential problem is that her mental illness, and that's really why she's filed. And the Social Security Administration does have an operations manual that talks about the mental demands of unskilled work.
Yes.
And when you review that, the categories, and there are a great many of them, did the ALJ have to take those into consideration in making this determination?
Well, I think the ALJ did take those into consideration in deciding that she was
explicit.
I don't know that it is explicit, but certainly the doctors, state agency doctors who evaluated her, took those demands into consideration. The ALJ then relied upon that analysis.
But I don't recall seeing that in the record. When the ALJ announced this decision, he relied on the state examiners, but I don't recall something explicit about the demands on skilled work based on the manual.
As I stated earlier, when a medical opinion is consistent with the RFC, the articulation requirement is lessened. And so that sort of analysis of breaking each one down, I don't think would be required in this situation.
By the record, is it?
The record is slipped.
And is a slippery record. I only have a couple minutes left, and so I wanted to also address the issue of the application of the grids. It's our position that the ALJ was justified in applying the grids.
Did they fully account for her mental illness?
Did they fully account for the limitations that the ALJ reasonably found in the RFC? Yes. So the grids incorporate, the grids aggregate all the unskilled jobs at each exertional level. And so for a claim with a light unskilled RFC like Ms. Ressler, that would be 1,600 different jobs between the sedentary and light level that the grids indicate that she could perform. Mr. Ewan relied really heavily on a single sentence in the Holohan case to claim that application of the grids is never appropriate with a claimant with mental impairments. So that is, number one, contrary to the agency's SSR 8515, which says that the unskilled job base provides substantial vocational opportunities for persons with solely mental impairments. And it also runs contrary to a number of decisions from this court, including, most tellingly, the Hupai'i case, which we raised in a 28-J letter a few days ago. That case involved both a physical and mental impairment, but the court explicitly said that even assuming if there was only a mental impairment, that the application of the grids in Step 5 isn't necessarily appropriate. And then we have subsequent decisions applying Hupai'i where the court says, where this court repeatedly applies the grids to cases with limitations on unskilled work, and also, importantly, in the context of this case, to claimants who have some limitations in social functioning, which there is some evidence, some ambiguous evidence from the medical opinion records that she has some social functioning limitations. So we submit that the Hupai'i decision is controlling, and the court should reject the plaintiff's Step 5 argument. In sum, while Ms. Ressler's mental impairments may have been worse in the past, they were not disabled for at least 12 consecutive months.
So your position is that the grids are okay because of the record in this case?
The grids are okay because of the record. It's a two-step process. And I think, with all due respect, that plaintiff gets it backwards by looking at the grids first and then the RFC first. If the court finds, that the RFC finding was supported by substantial evidence, and the only argument that plaintiff has made is related to the function-by-function assessment, which, as we stated in our brief, is not required by Ninth Circuit's case law. But if the RFC finding is legally valid and supported by substantial evidence, then the question becomes, is that RFC finding, are the limitations at RFC finding, are they consistent with the restrictions in the grids? And because this is an RFC for unskilled work, and the grids explicitly only include unskilled work in the jobs that they aggregate, then the grids would be appropriate in this case. So respectfully, the commissioner requests that the court affirm her final decision.
Thank you very much, counsel.
Could you just tell us right at the outset, what are you asking for? What relief are you asking for?
Remand for a de novo hearing, Your Honor, and a new decision in which the agency could then indicate or do what it said it was going to do, and an excerpt just in terms of engaging in the function-by-function analysis. This is what was indicated in Excerpt 29, just before the ALJ announced the residual functional capacity, that the analysis that was to follow was to be a more in-depth explication of the function-by-function analysis pertaining to mental impairments, so that would then inform the residual functional capacity. We see, as I indicated earlier, that the ALJ found opinions, or assessed weight to the opinions only to the extent that they were consistent with the RFC.
We had another Social Security case this week where the same language was used, where I guess it was
to the extent consistent with.
The extent consistent with.
Right.
Where does that language derive from? Is that in a case, or is that?
I'm not sure. I know that there are some cases that find that
it's almost circular. It's almost circular reasoning.
Oh, yes, I would agree it is. I certainly do agree that it's circular reasoning. And that's one of the reasons why I'm making that point now. As noted, Dr. Montoike was granted or assessed weight to his opinion to the extent consistent with the residual functional capacity. And in transcript 23, in one place we see that the ALJ noted that Dr. Montoike found only mild with respect to concentration, persistence, and pace, but the ALJ himself found in excerpt 28 moderate impairments in this area. And so, Judge Wardlaw, that would go back, at least in my opinion, that would go back to your question. Did the agency correctly assess Ms. Ressler's impairments? And in one place they're saying mild with respect to the same attribute, and yet in another, the ALJ is saying moderate with respect to the very same impairment, which is in this area, meaning concentration and persistence and pace. Moderate difficulties, that's excerpt 28. Later, it says mild, relying on Dr. Montoike. So how does that enable the court to review this decision adequately would be the question that Ms. Ressler would pose to you.
One last different point. The opposing counsel made the point that she didn't demonstrate disability during this two-year period, for a 12-month time during this two-year period. What is your response to that?
I believe that the evidence shows that the medical documentation shows that there is adequate support to demonstrate disability on the part of Ms. Ressler with respect to the way in which she's afflicted by the voices that she hears, the inability to stay on task. That was the basis, I would submit, the reason why her representative at hearing was asking for off-task time, 10%, 15%, but we didn't see that assessed in the decision, and I think that's another thing that I would ask that the court take into account.
Okay. Does anybody have anything else to ask?
Thank you.
No questions here.